Welcome everybody to this continuous series of webinars that Center for Global Languages is holding since 3rd of July. Today we are very happy to present the Chinese language and we have with us the most charming Madhushri, who is also the Chinese faculty at Center for Global Languages and is also the alumni of our department, having done Chinese here in the department. So welcome to you, Madhushri. Thank you for accepting to conduct this webinar. I will very briefly present to you Madhushri. Madhushri is an MBA graduate, and has learned Mandarin from our department, Center for Global Languages. And her journey began with Chinese language in 2013, and it has not stopped till today. So she has done various levels of Chinese language with us. And of course, she also holds the Chinese proficiency certifications also. She was also awarded the Confucius University Scholarship for 1 year to study in China. And this is, you know, another feather in her Mandarin cap, as she has, she mentions. As they say, no language is difficult to learn if every learning process is enjoyed and not seen as a burden. So I think that is very true, especially for Chinese language, because I think many people have this misconception that it's a very difficult language to learn. So I think we have the expert with us who is going to give us all the inputs today. So over to you, Madhushri, and thank you once again for being here.
Thank you, ma'am. Good afternoon, everyone. So like Jyoti ma'am said, I started my Chinese career, my language, you know, the passion, you know, my footsteps towards Chinese with Center for Global Language under Mr. Rao. So probably without the university support and my teacher support, I would have not been here on the other end listening, you know, or making you people hear what I have to say about the language. So maybe I'll give you a small, little more deeper, you know, introduction about myself as to how I got into the language. It all started, you know, way back in the 2000s where I was still in school. So I don't know if everyone remembers. So in Vijay TV on Fridays, they would have the Chinese Wushu, that is the martial art movies, dubbed in Tamil. So that's how, you know, my main, the interest, the passion for the language started off. So it was all basically, you know, those martial arts interests that I always wanted to learn Chinese because I wanted to know what is martial arts, like, you know, what are those easy steps that Jackie Chan does or Jet Li does. Back then, we didn't know anything much about that, at least, you know, with the technology, it's not as advanced as what it is today. So, you know, YouTube or internet was a very long procedure because the connecting itself would take like about an hour. So you can just imagine how long it's going to take for us to Google and research all of this. So that's when I started like, oh my God, Chinese, like, oh God, Chinese martial arts, Chinese wushu, and another thing. I never knew it was called wushu till I went to China. Always it was like kung fu, that is it. So that's how, you know, my interest for the language slowly, you know, just kept growing day by day. And then I started watching more martial art movies. Maybe it was in HBO or Star movies. So it was mostly all of those really classic, you know, really beautifully shot movies on martial arts itself. Ip Man and how martial arts, the different forms of martial arts and everything. Again, a disclaimer, back then also I never knew about Bodhidharma, though I had the interest of martial arts, but I had no clue about Bodhidharma, who he was, what he did, like nothing of that sort. So yeah, basically that's how, you know, my interest just kept gradually growing. And then like Chinese food, so again, what we see in India, Chinese food is not Chinese food, okay? So, but still I was like, okay, fine, noodles, or the Manchurians or fried rice, that was like in my head. And slowly, you know, I finished my schooling and then I got into my graduation. And then I realized that like any other European language, Chinese can also be learned as a curriculum. And there were many private institutes that were offering the language, as well as a university like, you know, our Bangalore, the Central College, which is again aided by the government. So I thought, okay, why not, you know, get into this, because I'll have more advantage or more value to the certificate than going to a private institute where probably I am paying triple the amount for it, but at some point maybe it's not valid. So, you know, that's how I got to know about the language. And in, like ma'am said, in 2013, I joined my first certification level. So back then it was 8 months. Since 2013, the course for certificate was 8 months. And like now, we're lucky enough that it is divided into semesters. So we go like, you know, C1, and then we get a break, and then we get back to C2. But then it was like 8 months and weekend classes again. So initially we were all like, wow, Chinese is like this, you know, so difficult to learn. It's hard to write. It's hard to read. It's hard to understand. But until unless we actually get into it, you know, until you get into the pool or water, you wouldn't know how deep it is, right? So that's how it was for me. The way, you know, my mentor, my sir, Mr. Rao, the way he took us through the language was really like, you know, a nice cake slide or cakewalk, what you would call it. You know, it was taken so smoothly. So all of the internet hype that Chinese is difficult, Chinese is hard, was like totally abolished by how the language was shown to us. And now, you know, me being a trainer myself, have been trying to introduce that, show people that how exactly the language is different from what people think. There's a lot of things that people need to know about the language and, you know, how it is or what it is about. So that's like a small sneak peek into, you know, myself and about Chinese language, my journey. Yeah, again, professionally also, it has helped me a lot. You know, though I did this as a passion and I just added it, you know, like an additional skill to my resume. And when I went to get jobs, so that was the first thing that was highlighting to people. Oh, Chinese, Mandarin Chinese. Wow. So all my, you know, degrees, my other education qualification didn't actually stand out, but Chinese did. So, you know, I'm proud to say that today I work with a, you know, well-known MNC as an accountant for the China region. So that way, it was like Chinese that is what's standing out these days. So everyone has to be unique. You know, like they say in economics, where, you know, demand is high, supply is less, you need to make use of that. So that way in India, we need to make, you know, the supply more for the Chinese language, where demand is high. Actually, the demand is high in market, but not everyone is aware of. Because the minute anyone says China, Chinese, you know, our things only go to the negative stuff, such as, you know, China products don't last long, they are cheap, they are this, you know, they have a bad effect. The Chinese eat, you know, everything that walks, flies, swims, you know, every stuff like that. But that is actually not what it is. Because personally, you know, I've lived in China for a year, and I know what exactly it is. So these are like the small introduction kind of stuff about Chinese. So maybe we can get into my presentation now. Okay, hope my screen is visible to everyone. So this is the actual Great Wall of China. Okay, there's a real picture of Great Wall of China through one of my travels in China. So this is one of those memes where everyone would have seen, you know, expectation versus reality. So this is one image that defines that expectation versus reality, because China, every tourist place, every place you think of on a weekend or a holiday is crowded. You can never go to a place and say that, wow, there's no people. So they also have a proverb in Chinese, Ren Hai, Ren Shan. That is, people are all over the sea and all over the hills. So that's how people are. So luckily, when I visited China, this is how it was. Not much of people, not very sunny. And, you know, it was a very pleasant climate to go up there. And another important thing about, you know, this the particular image, since it came up, the Great Wall of China, what we all think is it's just like one wall that is, you know, ranging from so many kilometers from here to there. It is like a protection wall. But to visit the Great Wall of China, we need to know that there are 8 different gates to reach to that. Not everyone is possible to visit the entire wall stretch from one end to another end at one point of time. So you have to, you know, decide like which part of the China you want to visit. So this is known as Padaling, the most famous and most visited part of the China, Great Wall of China, because of the way the wall has still been retained and restored also in most of the places. There's also another, the end part of China, the Great Wall of China, which is towards one of the beaches and sea. That's a really beautiful place to visit as well. So basically, that's about the Great Wall of China. So now let's get into the presentation. Okay, so let me, you know, kind of refresh our minds in terms of China or Chinese, the things that should come to our mind when we say Chinese. So generally, it is the panda, okay? Panda is actually original to the China. So, you know, like the history and, you know, or whatever you see outside is whenever you see a panda outside, it's more of the China who has blended the pandas on rent to other nations or other country or as gift or exchange. But otherwise, they actually belong to China. And these are really beautiful, clumsy animals to look at. So this is one of the picture of a real panda to one of my visits. And again, China, when you say panda, it is not, you cannot see a panda in all the provinces of China. It is only available in, you know, or is there for us to have a look at in a province known as Chengdu. Chengdu is a place where you will find pandas. So there's a research center in Chengdu. So that is where one of the picture is from. And, you know, they're really clumsy. When I say clumsy, you know, this panda out here, it took me like 15 minutes to take a picture of him or her. Because every time I try to click a picture, he or she is moving, trying to pull out the bamboo stick, the bamboo leaf, putting it in the mouth, they're playing, they're falling. And they just sleep, okay? Wherever you see any branch or anything, they're tired, they just fall asleep. So there's no question of us thinking that, okay, what happened? Like, is the panda dead, alive? So that's the kind of thing. And they're really cute animals. So pandas are, again, not only, you know, black and white. They also have the red and brown pandas, which are small. And they look more like a mixture of a cat and a dog. So I'm sorry, I couldn't get the picture of that though. So that is about, you know, another aspect of China. And then another thing that will come to our head in China when I say martial arts or wushu is the Shaolin Temple. So this is the Shaolin, the actual Shaolin Temple entrance. So like how we guys, you know, in India have these entrances or those welcoming pillars or walls would be called that. So this is something like that for the China martial art temple. That's known as the Shaolin Temple, where Bodhi Dharmin was there till he, you know, breathed his last. So that is one of the, you know, the temple images. So another positive thing that will come to our head when we think about China. And these are the real martial art monks or people who live there and they practice. So they have children from, you know, age of 6 or 8, 5 also, who, you know, dedicate their lives to learning the martial art, you know, because at that age is when your bone is still growing, it is flexible, it is soft. So the more you practice at that age, that is how more flexible your body can become and stronger as well. So, you know, each of them, you know, they go through such rigorous training, the food, the diet, everything is like so serious, they're so stern about everything. They practice for so many hours a day and still they have a very limited diet. And again, they don't encourage eating meat. It's not like, you know, supposed to eat. They don't encourage. It's again up to them how they want to eat and what they want to eat. Because they say the more you eat meat or more spicy food, it will ignite more aggression into one person. So that's the reason they tend to avoid all of this. And again, the food also, they don't eat much. They just eat a very little amount. So they keep their mind focused on what they need. So they can control their mind. So that's the main thing about any kind of martial art that we speak about, not only Shaolin Wushu, or there are so many different forms. So Wushu is actually the name for Chinese martial art that we generally know by the name as Kung Fu. So that's about Wushu and how they get into it. And it's a really beautiful sight to watch them practice every day of the different animals. You know, they have the monkey steps, they have the dragon, they have the snake, they have so many different, the eagle claws. You know, you just name it and then they have everything. So since they use these animal gestures into their martial art form, so that's the reason, you know, these names are derived into that. And another aspect about China or their culture would be their zodiac, you know, the story behind the, you know, their 12 zodiacs, like how we in India also follow the zodiac. But it is again based on the month here. So we also have 12, which is based on the month. But here in China, it is not based on the month, but based on the year of birth. So based on every year of birth, they have like, you know, 12 animals which represent each particular year. So basically, this again has a, you know, story behind this that at one point of time during, this is a myth, okay, a myth, a story or fable, what we want to call it. So that's when, you know, when all of these animals had a race as to who would reach first. And, you know, they would be designated over the first year. So that's how all of these animals had to cross a river from one end to another. So the order of which they crossed the river, they were given their years. That is, you know, starting with the rat or pig, the cow, or whoever it was. So that's again, like, you know, another lengthy story. So if I get into that, probably a little more boring. I don't want to make it a boring session though. So that's about you know, how the zodiac came into existence, and they very seriously follow that. And most of the time they also relate to people based on the year. So maybe when you meet somebody in China for the first time or the second time, like once they get to know you, you know, the first thing they ask is that is like, what is the year of your birth? So that way, when you tell them your year, or you tell them the animal, they automatically relate how your characteristics are related to these animals. So here, every animal has its own positive and negative characteristics. So they would relate you to that. And also another easy way for them is to get to know your age, because in China, they wouldn't ask you directly, like, what is your age? So they would just, you know, ask you for your year, and then they get to know, okay, fine, so this is how old you are. So I am a horse. According to the Chinese zodiac, I'm a horse. So people who want to get into the depth of this or to know how old I am, you can do a little bit of research. So, you know, a little work for the brain, or maybe you also can, you know, see what is your zodiac. So this is about the zodiac. Let's get into the next slide now. Okay, and now getting into a little bit of their form of art or culture, you know, how they evolved into that. So the first picture you see here, this is known as the paper cutting. Okay, the paper cutting, what, like, probably when you guys were in school or younger days, we would have a small paper cut where, you know, we would open it out. It would be like two people holding hands, or maybe a star, a book, or whatsoever. But this one are really detailed, intricate images of the paper cutting by just using scissor and blade, nothing more than that. So this is another very traditional art form, which is not very common these days, at least, you know, it's dying out. So this is you know, the art form, which is very beautiful to see. You know, you can cut out anything and everything. So this is again from one of you know, the events that happened in the college that I stayed in China. So this is a picture from that display. And then coming to their writing form, known as calligraphy. So these are the instruments or the pen, the paper, the ink that is required for one to do a calligraphy, a normal calligraphy in Chinese. Probably you must have seen all the welcome boards or the long hoardings in China or any movie. So those are all handwritten. So for that, these are the instruments, the ink, the pot, everything that's required just to mix the ink and the thickness of the brush. So this is a thick brush and this is a thin brush. This is the pot in which you mix the ink. You pour the ink. So you see these small black things here. So these are those plates on which you would rub. Okay. See, these are the coal or those ink chalks, you call them, which you would slightly use a drop or two of water on this, and you would slowly do like how we guys in South India, we take out the sandal from the sandal wood, right? So this is something like that, where you slowly add a little bit of water to the right consistency, and then that ink is what is transferred into the bowl here, and that is used for the writing. And similarly, here you see this painting again. This is another art form of China, where they use very minimalistic watercolors. If you see this, you can see that there's a horse in this image. You can see a goat, and then a couple of goats here again, and then a lady who's riding it, and then there's a sheep here. So all of this is done with just one or two colors, not beyond that. And it's all watercolors. And you can also see some writings here in calligraphy out here, which, is talking about a story or fable, or sometimes they write proverbs also based on the painting. So these are like another art form, which is not very commonly seen. At least people interested in art probably might have an idea about this. Otherwise, not many are aware of this. So these are a couple of things that not most of us actually know about the culture or their art forms in China. Again, music, they have a whole number of different kinds of instruments, made out of bamboo or wind instruments, a couple of string instruments also. They're also very different too here, and very beautiful also. Because I was personally there, I've attended a couple of events where they played, and it's so soothing. Sometimes they they help you sleep with peace as well. So those are the kind of traditional stuff that's still carried on. But again, how since modernization is building and growing up everywhere, these traditions are dying out with the old people. The new generation is not that interested in. So they just want to do, go to work, live their modern life, earn money, and just be there without any tension. So they don't want to get into all of this. So they don't want to waste their time on this. But there are still some people who are interested on, art forms like this, and they want to grow with this and keep the tradition alive. So that's how the art forms have still been kept alive in certain parts of China. And also about the singing, the operas, like drama, how we guys here have theater and drama, the traditional ones, for example, in South here in Kannada, in Karnataka, we have the Yakshagana. So they also have something known as the Beijing Opera or the Shanghai Opera, the Chengdu operas back there, where they have whole amount of makeup on their face, heavy costumes, heavy headgear and everything. It's difficult to stand with those. So people wear that and they perform on stage. And when they're performing on stage, probably it's difficult for any of us to understand, because it's more like in the form of a singing, but the dialect that is used, the spoken, is very different. Like similarly, how most of us don't understand even Yakshagana happens in Kannada, we don't understand. For most of us, because it happens as a song, and the Kannada or the language that is used is very different. So that's a little similarity I can give you. So coming to similarities, we have a lot common between India and China when it comes to the culture or the tradition, a lot of things. At one point of time, India was also known as the land of heaven, by the Chinese people. That is Tianzhu. So Tian is heaven, Zhu is a place. So people, where everyone is living in peace and a lot of nature. And stuff like that. So that way we can start relating our lives and their lives from the ancient to our culture, our tradition, and all of that. So here also, so now getting into culture and tradition, most of our festivals are also similar, you know, we follow the same kind, like how when it comes to any kind of festival back in India, it is always on a very grand note, you know, where you have large celebrations, colorful food, people, new clothes, or elder people giving money to the younger siblings, you know, taking blessings, family get-togethers, and food, like whole lot of food. So that's, you know, how there are so many things that is common. So let's just have a look into that right now. So this is about a little sneak peek into the culture and traditions that are most similar. Okay, so like I was saying, the traditional practices and customs are so much similar to our Indian Hindu, for example, you know, specifically our Hindu culture, you know, how we have a traditional wedding. They also have traditional weddings that happens in their traditional attire, which is of, you know, red color, and they also have a veil sometimes which covers their veil, and they worship nature, like how probably ancient India, we always worship God, the nature God, that is the sun, the moon, earth, water, and everything was nature worship, until like later now we have idolized gods as such, you know, defined. So similarly with China, as in when modernization and more of people, you know, coming and going, they also started getting into religion, where otherwise, since we spoke about religion, when it comes to China, they don't actually propagate, or they don't, what do I say, incline towards religion or caste system as such. For them, you're Chinese, you're Chinese. So they don't really get into religion as such. They don't have a specific religion. See, now when you say India, people will be like, okay, fine, the, you know, 80%, 50% of the population are Hindus. But in China, people have a wrong misconception that they're all Buddhists, but they're not. Since, you know, Buddhism was taken from here to China, so a couple of them at that point of time, whoever got into the preaching of Buddha, Lord Buddha, they got into Buddhism. So in China also, you have Hindus, you have Buddhists, you have Christians, you have Muslims, or whatever other religion that is possible. Now towards China, if you've seen the map of China, our border and their border are on the, that is the south of China. So that side, and towards the Pakistan, Afghanistan, so that part of China, you'll find a lot of Muslims and people who migrated towards the central or the east or the western part, there you'll find a lot of Christians also, and Buddhists, and they are different. And now slowly Hinduism is also growing in China. So that way, you know, in terms of culture and religion, they are also diverse. And then coming to another point is like how we in India, we, apart from the Western calendar, we also follow the lunar calendar for our festivals, right? So we don't, even though we celebrate New Year on the 1st of January, we still have our individual New Year's. For example, we have Ugadi, we have Pongal, we have Gudi Padwa, you know, stuff like this. So they also have one New Year, which is followed based on the lunar calendar. Similarly, we also do that. For most of the festivals in India, it is followed by the lunar calendar, irrespective of what the Western calendar says. So that is another aspect which is common between us. And then coming to temples, so like how we have old traditional temples, you know, which are really beautifully, magnificently built, similarly in China also, that is when they were doing the nature worship. So they have huge temples which are built. If you all remember, in India, when you enter temples, you have the guards, like, you know, the god of the has guards, you know, outside the temple, the idols of gods, or they're known as the sun and the moon, right? So similarly in China also, every time you enter a temple, you would find two idols on the right and the left. They're known as the guards of the temple. You know, one is the angry god, one is the calm god, or you have the sun god, you have the moon god. So that way it was very you know, fascinating for me, and I had relating this to like how close as a culture we are to you know, China, or our ancestors and their ancestors, like how closely knit we are, but still we are so different from each other. So that way, and you know, they went on. But later, temples were started to be built for the emperors. At you know, based on the different dynasty, the temples were started built in the name of the emperors. The main shrine, you know, they would have the idol built of a particular emperor who's done really good, or other you know, stuff like that. And even some temples, there was Bodhidharma also. So that was about you know, the temples, and then slowly moving into martial arts. So most of the temples which I had visited in China, they had a separate place within the temple where they practiced martial arts, different forms of martial arts, not only wushu, there are different form of martial arts as well. For example, tai chi, what we, you know, we say it's a slow movement of the hand, like how you control. See, basically chi means the strength, the inner strength, the spirit, the energy. So this is like how you slowly control the energy within ourselves, and how, you know, we are composed, like how well we get composed by following all of this, whether it could be meditation or anything, martial arts and yoga. Now yoga, though it originated in India, slowly it is losing its you know, importance here, but whereas in China it is gaining importance now. A lot of people want to learn yoga over there. They're ready to pay anything to anyone who's ready to come and teach yoga over there. They want to practice traditional methods. They want to do all of that. And another interesting thing that I found out in China was people who are above the age of 50 and 60, 70, 80 also, every day they practice tai chi. They practice some kind of martial art form, dance, music, everything of that sort in public places. So every time you go out to China in the evening in public places, you would find a whole bunch of whole group of people. You know, when I say old people, I mean like literally 60, 70, where most of the time back here you would find them lying on the bed, or you would tell, you know, like, you know, they're old, they're not enough to strong enough to stand, they can't do their own work. But here people are healthy, you know, it's standing upright, they're doing their work, they're doing their workouts, they're doing their exercises, they still practice the harsher form of martial arts as well. So that was really fascinating for me in terms of dancing or singing. But you just have to walk out in the evening to public places in China. That's a real sight to watch. So that is about the martial arts. And comes to medicines also. See, India is known basically famous for its Ayurvedic medicines, right? So similarly, China also have their medicines, which is traditional medicine, like how we use the roots and those jadi booty, what you call them, and the different concoctions. China still follows, most of them still follow that. So here you would hardly find medical stores still sending you roots and stems, you know, if you're sick. But in China, you go to a normal medical store that is a little within the suburbs of the city, or a place where it is traditionally followed, not like totally a huge city like Beijing or Shanghai. You still find a medical store which is stacked with so many stems and roots and different kind of pulps or everything which is traditional follower Chinese. So that way, you know, there are so many things when you get into the depth of this, like there is no end. So that way we are actually a very close knit in terms of culture and traditions that we follow. Like how we here also follow certain traditions when a child is born, or at time of marriage or after marriage and everything. There again, it's the same way. They have their own traditions when a child is born, what has to be done, what not to be done, how a child is named. And another thing is in India, how importance is given to a surname. Similarly, in China also. So there they use their surname and then their given name. So as in when you get into the depth of it, you would actually start loving the culture, and you wouldn't have any bigger culture shock as such, like how you would actually feel that, oh my God, it's a new country, a new place, a new language or such, you know, even a visit. I'm just saying if that's a visit, you wouldn't find greater culture shock until, unless it's a very huge city urbanization again, where now they're getting into a lot of westernization. So that way, you know, culture and tradition is on, and we can get into more into the culture and traditions now. So this is about the different kind of festivals. Okay, sorry. So these are the most common and the famous festivals, like how we guys here, you know, we have our main festivals such as the New Year, then we have Diwali, and then in between we have other main festivals, again depending on different regions. So similarly in China, every region, which is also known as the province, have their own importance, their own you know, festivities, like how they celebrate it. So of that, I've just picked a handful of the most commonly celebrated festivals throughout China. So the first one would be, like, as most of us should be aware of, should be the Spring Festival, or also known as the Chinese New Year, which is also known as Chunjie. Chun by itself means spring, and Jie means festival, so Chunjie. So this again is celebrated based on the lunar month. So it is the first 15 days of the first lunar month. So once their lunar calendar starts, so sometimes it could be in the month of January or February, anytime between that, never beyond or never after that. So between Jan or February is usually their first lunar month. And the first 15 days, like a straight 15 days, China is shut down fully for any kind of offices, schools or government offices also. Everything is shut down, and all the people who are working outside, they all get back to the city to be with their family. Similarly, like how it happens here, any festival, the family gets together. So that is a very big thing in China. So 15 days straight, you know, you're on a festive mode. Anywhere you go, you would see lanterns, you would see dragon dance, you would see the lion dance, the music, the different, they organize so many different kind of games for families. It's just a beautiful sight. But then again, you should be very lucky if you get a chance to be in China during that time, because it's very difficult for a tourist to get visas during that time of the year. And if you're already there in China, and if you're there during that time, just have to make sure that we do get a gist of at least a little bit of celebration. That's how beautiful it is, the music, the drums and everything. So that's, you know, how the New Year begins. And then the last day of the New Year is known as the Lantern Festival. So that is, again, celebrated on the 15th of the first lunar month. That is the last day. But the Lantern Festival is, again, all about lights, the colorful lights. If you can see the background here of this presentation is a lantern again. They have different kinds of forms of lantern. You have the long one, you have the round, you have the square one. Then you have the ones where you have artificial light inside, or where you have the candle and you can just leave it out like that. So that's about the Lantern Festival. That's like the closing of the new year, the beginning of a new the new eve or the spring. So again, another thing about the Spring Festival is that the time the Spring Festival starts is when China has just done with all the winter part. So in winter, it snows in most part of China. So that time when the spring starts is the snow is all melting, all the trees, all the flowers, everything is blooming. There's so much of greenery, the flowers. It's so beautiful. It's a very beautiful sight to watch. You have different color flowers growing everywhere. The university which I lived in also had the cherry blossoms, and that was a beautiful sight. Like, and I never expected I would get a chance to experience the cherry blossoms, and they were so beautiful. The light pink, you also have white in that, so that's like a really beautiful thing. So that's so that's again a beginning, a new beginning, like how we guys do Pongal here, the harvest, right? The harvest festival. So that is also similar to that. And then as we come down to the other kind of festivals, so here back in India also we do celebrate one of the days for our dead ancestors. So that again happens in China as well, which is known as the Qingming Festival, where they worship the people who have lost their life, who passed on, and they go to the grave, they offer they clean up the grave, they offer the special prayer for them, they cook the food that they like, and and everything for that particular person, like whoever is no more with them. Similarly, that happens with us here as well. Apart from the day that we have a special puja for someone who is no more, you also go and do a particular puja for everyone who's passed off, right? So this is another similarity, a big similarity, which I'm not sure if everyone is aware of. So that's about the Qingming Festival. For that particularly, they don't follow the lunar calendar in most part of China, at least from my knowledge. but it happens with the general solar calendar, that is the Western calendar. It happens in the month of April. So it could be anytime between the first week, you know, the first to fifth or anything around that time. And then as we go down, then we have another festival known as the Dragon Boat Festival. So this is celebrated in the fifth lunar month on the fifth day. So this boat festival is again has another fable attached to it, and the story attached to it, where you know, one of the emperors was you know, pushed into the water, and the fishes ate him up. So every year around that point of time, so people make sweet rice balls or dumplings, and you know, they throw them into the water so that the fishes eat off that rice ball and not the emperor. And they have the boat races, the boat festivals, where you know, you disturb the water, the fishes, or they don't come and eat off the body. So that one is like another actual reason why the Dragon Boat Festival is held, and that is again a real beautiful sight to watch when you know you're there, the drums beating. If you remember, like in the movie Ben-Hur or the Ten Commandments, where you have the drums beating and people have to row according to the beat. The faster you beat the drum, the faster they have to row. So similar thing you would find here, you know, with right in front of your eyes, and the beautiful colorful dragons and the boats in the shape of a dragon, or the decorations, the people, the food, everything. It's a really beautiful sight again, Dragon Boat Festival. And then coming to another one is known as the Mid-Autumn Festival. So this again is a very get-together family kind of a festival, where it happens, you know, in the 8th of lunar month on the 15th day. So here again, it's, you know, since it says Mid-Autumn Festival, and it's more about, you know, a day of a full moon. Okay, so the entire family, they all catch up, they meet, they make the really delicious food, you know, whether it is sweets or, and the most, like for example, again, here I can give you is when we have Ganesh Chaturthi here, we make those sweet modaks, right? So moon cake, so they make something known as a moon cake, which is similar to that. But here again, the moon cake, again, you have a mold, and then you have it's like a pastry dough, but not exactly. It's like a pastry dough, which is a little thicker, and it doesn't have much sweet into it. And then you have a nice ball kind of a sweet. It can either be sweet, it could be dry fruits, sometimes it could be egg. See, the moon cake, again, it's not like, see, for us, when we say cake, it's more about the cream, the different layers, the toppings, and the smells. But with moon cake, it's not like that. It's a very different thing. It's just the main essence of the cake is first the mold and the design of the cake. So you have these different molds, like how we have for a modak. So these are round in shape, or nowadays you're getting different kinds, but otherwise they're traditionally round in shape. Earlier were made of wood, where you keep the pastry or the dough, and then you put the filling inside, and then you just press it and take it out. You don't have to cook them, you don't have to heat or boil them. Again, it depends on the different kinds. So you have a lot of that. And the moon cake is not sweet at all. Okay, you get a different kind of ball taste. Again, it's not too sweet, it doesn't have taste at all, I wouldn't say that, but a little tinge of taste where you would savor every ingredient of the cake. So that is a very you know, important festival for them, where you know they all spend the night. You know, the day of the Mid-Autumn Festival is usually a full moon day, so the entire family spends the time together. They sit out, you know, they enjoy the moon, and they also have certain songs, you know, which is related to the moon and all of that. So these are some of the common festivals, again, like how you know, we celebrate back in India. So now let's get into the next slide. So now coming to food. So for this, I would like to say, you know, let's think of China beyond meat, or, you know, beyond everything we say, you know, we think that is actually about Chinese food. So this is China, the map of China, where you can see different provinces. So here, yeah. Since I'm using the word province a lot of time, like how in India we say state, so in China they use the word as province. So each province is like a different state, and like how, you know, how in India we have different food for each state, and you know the speciality of that. So that's just like about this. So this is the Inner Mongolia part, and this is Beijing. So each of them have their own. And now coming to something, this is Sichuan. This is Sichuan province, which again, should not everyone is aware of Sichuan. But the minute you say Sichuan, everyone's like, oh yeah, Sichuan. So in the whole of China, not every province eats spicy food. Okay, they not every Chinese spicy food, and there are certain provinces which do eat, but they're not that spicy. And when I say spicy food, for us here, we have a lot of masalas which add to the spice. But in China, it is the chili by itself, the chili which is ground very fine, or different kind of red chilies or green chili that is finely ground and used as the paste. So when it comes to that, Sichuan is a province where you kind of get a little spices and the taste which is similar to our kind of spicy food. So that is the reason, they say Sichuan is, a province which eats spicy food, and you want to eat some spicy food, you can go to Sichuan. So that is how the name Sichuan is derived from. So that Sichuan paste or the Sichuan sauce, which, the global is actually known as, is nothing but some Sichuan province. So that's about the Sichuan province. So, and as far as the Shanghai, each province by itself have their own different food, because here they're mostly inclined towards Pakistan, Afghanistan, Kazakhstan, all of that. So here they're mostly influenced by a lot of beef here. So on this part you get a lot of beef and a lot of Muslims, and here in Mongolia you have like different kind of food habits. Here towards the sea, a lot of seafood, any kind, different kinds of seafood. The central also different, and also China, you would actually find really very good authentic vegetarian food which you don't find here. I was surprised, and most of the time I did live on a vegetarian food in China, which is a big surprise to most of them. So so that's about the different kinds of food. So let us get into a little detailing into that. So this, again, when it comes to breakfast, generally people always have that in them, right? Like, what do Chinese people eat for breakfast? They only eat meat. Like, there are so many different varieties of breakfast in China, and most of them are vegetarian. You have soups. Like, when I say soup, it's not like how we get in our fancy restaurants here, really small bowl, and then, which is has a nice good garnishing on top, which smells great, and then they charge you like 3-4 times the quantity of the thing. But here in China, you would get like a really large bowl. When I say large bowl, I am literally not exaggerating, but it's a really large bowl of soup over there. So the soup can be any kind of soup. So the soup is known as tang. Okay, soups in China known as tang. So you get, soya bean sauce, soya bean soup, and then egg soup. Then you get vegetable stock soup. There are so many different kinds of soup. You name it, and then they have it. And then you have the egg white soup also, which tastes really very good. And then you have these veg steamed buns. Then again, you have veg filled steam buns again, which are really very tasty. I would love them. They were known as baozi, and they were all of cabbage mixed. And sometimes you would have veg and non-veg mixed also. So you'd get the baozi with a little bit of cabbage and maybe tiny shrimps or pieces of egg or chicken, whatever you want to. But you would also get veg again if you want veg. And then you had different kind of cakes and pastries. And you would get like how you known as the peat, the one you would get mostly into the eastern part of the world, that is the peat, where so you eat the shawarma, right? Something like that, yeah. So you would stuff whatever you want to inside, whether it is veg or non-veg, and then have a small burger. So this is something like that. And then again, you have momos or dumplings, what we are known, we already know here. So that, again, you have two kinds. Then you have the steamed, then you have the fried, and you also have the soup one. So where you have a big bowl of soup and you have these dumplings which are soaking into them. So you enjoy your soup as well as the dumpling. So that, so the breakfast itself, again, it just goes on. There's no end for that. And they eat a lot of fruits also. Sometimes, breakfast can just be two big bananas or an apple. for that matter, even steamed corn. They eat a lot of corn again. And Chinese food, again, they're so much into their health. You would not find an obese Chinese person. Like, pick out 10 people, it's hard to find at least one. So that is how well-dietitian, even though they eat so much, they do so much, they have so much of meat, so much of heavy food, but everybody out there, you find them like really lean. When I say lean, I wouldn't say, they don't, that they look malnutritioned, but they are fit, they are healthy and fit. So that is their secret again. So their biggest secret about that is, no matter how much meat or whatever they intake, they drink really hot boiling water. So once you do that, the meat by itself, it gets digested inside. And it's all about the breakfast and more into the food. So let's get into a little faster onto this. And then again, these are those different vegetarian foods. Okay, all of the thing you platter you see here, it is all vegetarian food. And this is how food is served in China, whether you go to a restaurant or you go to somebody's house. Okay, it's like all the different kind of food is set out like this, and each of us would have our plates and our chopsticks. So we would help ourselves with whatever we want to. So this is how they all eat, where you have your own small plate or bowl, and then you pick up what you want to eat with the same chopstick that you used to eat. So these are all vegetarian, the different kinds of vegetarian, tofu, eggplant. This is again some kind of potato shredded, and this is egg soup, I think. Yeah, around egg soup, and this should be the lotus stem. So all of the food you see here is vegetarian. So this is something which not everyone is aware of, that Chinese eat vegetarian food. And another thing also is that, like, for us here, we need to have rice with all of this, right? Like, we need rice and curry, but that doesn't work like that. So you just eat this much, and then maybe a really small bowl of rice. The bowl size I'm talking about here is the bowl size where what we use to get these fancy soups. Yeah, so that is the size of the bowl you get to just have some rice. That's a sticky rice again. So because when you use a chopstick, you can easily pick up the rice and you can eat it more easily. So just a small side dish. But this is what you would be served in China if you ask them like for a proper platter or meal. This is a small gestures about this, and not more about that. And that's about the vegetarian food. And then these are another most famous and really delicious sweets, really delicious sweets. So this is kind of a ball, sweet ball, which has a sesame on top, and it tastes like really good. Okay, it gives you the texture of a little jelly kind of a thing, but again, it just melts in your mouth. And another thing that China is very famous for are these sugar dipped fruits. So most of the fruits you want to eat there, you do get fresh fruits, but also these sugar dipped candies. Okay, so these are cherries. Then this could be the same for oranges, or you would get for kiwis, you would get for anything of that sort. So this is all about the different kinds. And this is the mooncake that I was referring to. So maybe a lot of the food. So let's get into a little bit into the language now. We'll be getting into the language. So basically Chinese. So what is Chinese as such? The Chinese is one of the really oldest language in the world when it comes to the maintenance of the authentic the history of the language, which dates to so many years ago. I'm not getting into the numbers now. So that way, it is something that has been kept alive, which has been carried forward by tradition. So we would know that around the globe, when you get into the globe, there are Chinese is number one for its population. So based on that, again, the number of native Chinese speakers are more. And then again, now you have slowly people learning Chinese as a language into they're adding into the curriculum. Into the curriculum or into their life, their business or whatsoever. So Chinese is getting a lot into all of this. So that way it becomes one of the most spoken language in the world by native and non-native. and another aspect of the Chinese language. See, when I say Chinese, I'm not referring to Mandarin Chinese in particular. We'll get into that a little later. But now Chinese as a whole. Now we'll get into Chinese as a whole. So otherwise, Chinese is a tonal language. So Chinese here, the first thing you need to know is that it's more into tones. So the language is built on the tones, the different kind that it has specific tones on which the language is spoken or used. And then it has different dialects. So like how each province I was referring to, each province speaks Chinese, but the Chinese is based on the dialect of that particular province again. But the official language becomes Mandarin. So, and another important aspect of Chinese you need to know is that they don't have alphabets. So Chinese is a language which doesn't have alphabets. For example, here, you see these two here, these are known as characters. See, in English, I need to write C-H-I-N-E-S-E. Whereas here in Chinese, it is just two words or two characters or whatever you want to call them. It's just two things here. You know, these two words or these two characters make up the word Chinese. See, that again is like an easier thing. Now, if I have to write this thing in Chinese, it would not take me, you know, this much of space. It would just take me like one single line. So that is the beauty of the language when it's coming to the character or like how it is, you know, the written script. See, Chinese, anybody can learn when it comes, you know, to spoken. But the written script is what is the beauty or the essence of knowing a language. So again, now coming to Mandarin Chinese. From Chinese, we're just moving into Mandarin Chinese in particular, which is known as the official language of China. And also, not only in China, you also use Mandarin in Taiwan. You use Mandarin in Singapore, in some parts of Hong Kong, and in other parts of the world. For example, Canada also. So lately, Canada has also introduced Mandarin language into their curriculum in school itself. So now getting into that. For Mandarin language, we have two types of written scripts. One is known as the traditional Chinese, and then you have the simplified Chinese. The traditional Chinese is known as the fan tizi, and the simplified Chinese is known as the jian tizi. So what we use is the simplified Chinese. What we write is this, the jian tizi. So most of the Chinese people, when you know Mandarin and you speak, they can understand most of it because it's more or less the same. But writing is a little different when it comes to the traditional writing and the simple writing. Then again, another advantage with Chinese is that the grammar is very, very simple. It's a simple subject, verb, object structure, nothing beyond that. It's just subject, verb, object. And then you introduce the time, the front or in the back or wherever. Then they don't have tenses. They don't have plurals, you know, like pens or books, men, women. It doesn't work like that. It's just plural. And the meaning of the sentence changes as in when, you use the context also. And to help us learn Chinese a little more easy for each character, like I said, since we don't have alphabet, we have something known as the pinyin. So the pinyin for this is han yu, so h-a-n-n-y-u, the English letter. So han yu. So based on that, we get to learn the pronunciation. So again, like I said, han, these Chinese characters are known as hanzi. So characters are known as hanzi. So generally, most of the Chinese, the native Chinese themselves, they don't know how. So many characters that probably we non-native speakers know because we've been learning them, we've been practicing and writing them. But most of them, they're not very good at writing also. Probably they're good at speaking, they can recognize. But when it comes to writing, they tend to, forget or they miss it because that is how any language works. Right? You stop practicing it and then you don't get enough practice, you forget it. So that's how the characters work. And then just a little bit inside into the characters. So Chinese characters are of basically six different types or four different types based on different studies. So these are the easy ones. So when I say the language is very easy, so this is one of an example. So it is one form is known as the pictogram, so which is derived from the image representation. For example, this is the sun, right? So slowly started evolving into a character known as R. So this is when you see this character here, it could be the sun, it could be the day, or anything, but then you know this is it. And this is the moon. So when you move towards that, and this is the moon. So you would find this character in the month also. And then this is the tree. So the tree was slowly drawn and defined into this. And this is the mountain or hill. So this is again, so simply just very simple, logical pictorial description. And this is water, like how water flows. So this is how our water flows. So this is about the water. And this is the land or the field or where you do cultivation. So this is which is slowly divided into this. It could be land or field, anything of that sort. And then this is again door. So when you have two doors, so the door is, you know, open, then it was written like this, and later, you know, which simplified into this. So these are very simple. So once you understand the concept of the characters, it's very easy to understand. And then you have another one where, you know, they're known as ideograms, which are derived from the little representation. Now, for example, you see this, like, for us, the fossil comes, this is one. So yes, this is the Chinese number one, and this is two. So this is nothing but the Chinese number two, and this is number three, the Chinese number three. So maybe you all can, you know, guess the rest of them. So this is something like this, which is representing something that is above, and this one is referring to something that is below, and this one is something that is in the middle, and this one is something representing below this. So there could be the root. So below that is the root. So this way, once you get into the language, it's easy for you to relate everything. You can understand everything better. You know, it's more easier for us to get into all of this and, you know, apply it into the practical of the language. So let's get into more of, you know, how romanized, how the pinyin actually works. Okay, like, I'm not going to get in too much of this. So this is more of the English romanization, like pa, ma, wu, chur, chur. So these are those, opinion for these particular characters. And then, which I since already said, it's a tonal language. So these are the four tones. So you have the flat tone, and then you have the high tone, and then you have the high, low, and the high tone. And then you have the low tone, and then you have neutral tone. So that's how, you know, the language works. So each meaning or each word of the language changes based on the meaning and the tone again. You know, getting a little deeper into the language aspect, into the terms of the proficiency exam. So there's something known as the HSK exam, which is known as the proficiency exam. So which until 2022, there are only six levels, that is HSK 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, which is like, you know, level 1 being the lowest and level 6 being the highest. But later, you know, with it towards the end of 2020 and 21, they introduced additional three levels. So right now we have up to HSK 9. Okay. And this is about the written and the reading aspect of the proficiency exam. Then you also have another proficiency exam, which is known as the HSKK, which is again the oral exam. So this has like three parts of it, which is HSKK 1, 2, and 3, 3 being the highest and one being the lowest. And you also have, you know, another two forms, which is known as the BCT and the YCT. So the BCT is the business Chinese test, which will help mostly people, you know, who are interested to business. So that, you know, the characters, the number of words you learn in business Chinese is a little different from the regular Chinese. Similarly with youth Chinese, it's more for children or kids, where the syllabus is again different. So the advantages, let me get into the advantage a little sooner on to this. So when you do an HSK exam, first thing is you can test your own proficiency. Okay, so you learn your language in any university or institute, you get certified. But sometimes when you go abroad, they ask you for the HSK, that's the proficiency exam. So you need to show them that based on their proficiency levels that you are meeting the standards. So that is one thing. And second thing is, like, you know, introduction was said that I was awarded the Chinese scholarship, fully paid Chinese scholarship. So I was the first one to get it from the Bangalore University for 1 year. So we had another senior who had applied for 2 years for an MA. And then for 1 year, I was the first one from Bangalore. So that is a very big privilege for us as well. So the entire studies, your stay, and then you also get a monthly stipend to stay and study over there. So the advantages of that, again, is you going there on a student visa. So any places that you visit or whatever you do, you know, you can use your student visa as an advantage on to getting into discounts on your tickets when you do, you know, tourist place, when you visit all of that. And then again, Once you move HSK, you can easily apply for jobs also in China. See, there are many people who know Chinese already, but there are certain things that we have an upper advantage of English over there. So once we give them our Chinese proficiency exam again, you can get into the jobs easily over there. And another relation that I want to say in terms of learning the Chinese language from the Center for Global Language is that after I did my certification level and my diploma level, I directly gave HSK 3 exam. So that is how well prepared the course is here. Once you do the certificate course, you can directly take HSK 3. HSK 1 and HSK 2 is are compulsory. See, in the proficiency exam, you don't have to go stepwise. You can pick any level that you're confident enough of. So I did my certificate here. I thought, okay, let me give HSK 2. And then before I started my diploma, I gave HSK 3 directly. And wow, it was like, so easy. It was like cakewalk for me because I am learning so much beyond what HSK level 3 is giving me in a simple certificate course that I learned in the university here. So that way now with, going up to level 9 and the, our syllabus in the university is like really ahead of everything. So that's another advantage for us to clear these exams faster and easier, and we don't have to go for any kind of additional HSK courses or classes outside. Okay, and then getting into a little bit of professional thing. So what are the benefits of learning Chinese as a language? First thing is it becomes like an additional skill in your resume. Like I said, for me, my personal experience again, where the minute people saw the word Chinese or the language as a skill, they were ready to give me a job for their requirement because the demand was there and they didn't have enough people to get that. And another a rare combination of other education background. So when I'm referring to this, for example, I am a medical student, okay, or I am someone who's done a professional education in maybe law, accounts or whatsoever, I'm going to relate that into the language. So I'm going to combine both of them. I'm going to be a rare combination that is available in the market. For example, I'm a commerce background who specializes in accounts. So now I'm working as an accountant for a China region based company where I'm using the Chinese and the accounts that I know into one. So I'm applying my concepts here. So not many people will have that. For example, you want to do law. You've done law and then you do Chinese. You're combining them again. So that way you become a very unique, rare combination, which not many one would do. Maybe, you would find 100 engineers, but in 100 engineers, you wouldn't find, one person or two, 100, maybe you'll find two or three who have a combination of a particular language and their education. And then again, coming into the government job opportunities, you get a lot of opportunities in the government jobs, such as into the IB or the FRRO, maybe the embassy or the ministry, the foreign ministry. Sometimes if you're really good, you can even be the translator to the foreign delegates or to the prime minister himself, or there are so many other things. And then, the regular language interpreters, translators, you have on-the-spot translators, you have interpreters, on-the-spot interpreters, then you have content writers, and you also have scribes or people who write subtitles for movies. You understand a movie, and when I'm saying subtitles, I mean, say, for example, it's an English movie and then you need Chinese subtitles. For example, now when I was in China, the movie Bahubali was released in Chinese. Okay, so the dialogues, the wordings, everything was so perfectly translated into Chinese. I was surprised, and I watched the movie in the theater and it was jam-packed. It was crowded. It was so beautiful. And there were other American movies also, which, were dubbed in Chinese with Chinese subtitles. So these are, again, different rare combinations you would find. And then tourist guides, you have language trainers, then, you get jobs in the IT sector, you get jobs in the MNCs, and then you can become a freelancer as well. You don't really have to work under someone. You have to find a job. So you become a freelancer as well. So, there are so many other, professional benefits that you get. So now coming into a little bit of, the DCU. So what the courses that I know that is offered here. So you have the certificate level, like I already said, is divided in the semester wise now, that is C1 and C2. So you clear your C2, you can get admission in, you clear your C1, you get your admission into C2. This is certificate one and certificate two. You successfully clear this, you can do your diploma level exam. So before that, you want to give a try on HSK exam as well, a proficiency exam. You're most welcome to. So that also you can do, it again add to your thing. Once you do your diploma level, then you have your higher diploma level, and then you have your advanced diploma level. So here, when we're talking about all of this diploma, it is not defined only to literature or only to business. It is an overall exposure to every aspects of a language which is required for us professionally. Okay, like how, you know, people when, sorry, how people when they get into BAs and MAs, it's more of literature and nothing beyond. But the advantage we get here is we already have a professional education, for which we're just adding additional skills or additional feathers, or, you know, just what we want to call it, to your resume, to give it a different weightage. Like I always say, be a different combination, a different concoction, which is very rarely available to anybody. So that's about what I wanted to give. Probably I think I've gone beyond what's required. So yeah, thank you. So that's about the language, the culture, and my experience and everything about China. Thank you. Ma'am, if you're speaking, on mute.
Sorry. Thank you, Madhushree. That was a very wonderful and an insightful visit to China and back.
Thank you.
really fascinating. And I think, people have got really a very good idea about the country, because it is such a kind of a closed country. We don't really know much about it. And there are a lot of misconception sometimes. And I think today you have really cleared those doubts. And great. And as you mentioned, the courses that we are offering in Chinese in the department. And if I may add, we'll be starting the admissions soon. Because of pandemic, we could not start the admissions in month of July. So we hope to start the admissions from month of August, and hopefully start the classes from month of September. That is the tentative plan that the university is looking at, and hopefully we will be able to follow that, of course keeping COVID in mind. So thank you once again, Madhushree, for a wonderful enlightening webinar and presentation. And if people have any questions, they can always write to us at cgl.bcu@gmail.com, and Madhushree will be happy to answer your queries. Thank you once again, everybody, and we will be back soon.
Thank you.